Evening, with staggering speed, a fire has destroyed a seven-storey building in the inner city suburb of Surry Hills. It took just minutes for the first sign of flames to erupt into an inferno, engulfing the entire structure, walls collapsing onto the street. On the scene, as we go to air, 20 fire trucks and more than 100 firefighters.
An inferno in the heart of Sydney, a seven-storey brick building on Granville Street, Surry Hills, disappearing into the flames. A wall of fire seen across the CBD. Flames lapping at surrounding buildings and destroying cars on the street outside. Thousands of peak hour commuters watch on as trains continue to pass by at nearby Central Station. 4 o'clock, and this was the moment the emergency began. Smoke pouring out of the second floor, flames take hold. The roof, the first to disappear into the flames. The structure weakened and the walls came tumbling down. Crashing onto the building next door and into the alleyway. Thankfully, there was no one around. Reporter James Wilson witnessed it all.
As we were running from one side of the street to the other, we heard this massive bang followed by this burst of flames and sparks and embers, and that was a big chunk of this building collapsing.
Within minutes, there was a domino effect. Two other walls came down, one after the other. The mission for the 100 firefighters and 20 trucks on the ground: protect the surrounding buildings. At one point, the flames jump across the road to nearby rooftop gardens. Crews were quick to react, saving the apartment block.
Some of the buildings surrounding had gas bottles on the roof and they were worried about explosions. My friend was at home and had the balcony door ajar, smelled the smoke and came outside.
Even standing in the doorway of a neighbouring business, it felt like we were cooking, that we were roasting.
I kind of came home and it's like a war zone down there.
As the sun faded, the sky was filled with smoke and an eerie orange glow. The cause of the fire will become the centre of the investigation. Damien Ryan, Nine News.
And our reporters are standing by on the ground in Surry Hills. Let's go first to Sophie Upcroft. Sophie, what's the situation as we come to you?
Well, Pete, it's still very much an unfolding emergency here in the city. You can see that there are hundreds of people still watching on, taking in this spectacle from outside the exclusion zone here. That exclusion zone goes right around the fire, around a 100-metre radius around that fire. Inside, firefighters are still very busy. They are fighting this fire mostly from the air still at this stage, dousing the flames inside that seven-storey building. We understand that that building was vacant and that it had been slated for redevelopment. There are so many people here taking in the site. Pete, this is the largest fire that we have seen in Sydney since 1968. That's the largest fire in 55 years. So the firefighters here certainly have their work cut out for them.
OK, Sophie, we'll leave you there. Let's move to James Wilson, who's nearby at Central Station. James, there has been some disruption to people's commute home.
Pete, the light rail services have been disrupted. This is the Chalmers Street station out the front of Central. That's fallen inside the exclusion zone set up by police this afternoon. But remarkably, train services have been going uninterrupted. We're just out the front of Central Station, platform 23. This is only 50 metres from where this inferno burst into flames this afternoon. But we've seen no impact on train delays at all. We've seen commuters move freely into the station and catch the train home. And that's been one of the positives out of this situation as police try to manage the scene right next door. Pete, at the moment, firefighters are still working to contain that blaze and particularly stop it from spreading to this residential apartment right next door. But at the moment, it does seem like they have the situation in hand. Pete?
OK, James, thank you. Senior police are backing the actions of two colleagues involved in the fatal shooting of a man who'd lunged at officers with knives at North Willoughby on Sydney's Lower North Shore. The suspect had earlier threatened residents in the street. The confrontation now the subject of a critical incident investigation.
A man lies dead in the driveway of a house on Alexander Street, North Willoughby. Two carving knives are close by. and two local schools are sent into lockdown.
One of the sons who lives there, potentially with mental health, was maybe yelling and screaming.
Police arrived at the house around 11:30 this morning after reports the man was threatening residents. He also, according to officers, confronted them. And that's when they opened fire with four shots to the body. Neighbour Mujahid Diwali heard the lead up to the shooting.
One guy is just crying and like shouting, "I'll kill you, I'll kill you."
Residents say after they heard the man shouting, about 8 minutes elapsed before they heard the four gunshots. Another critical incident involving police, this time headed by the Assistant Commissioner, Leanne McCusker.
A male that was behaving erratically, behaving aggressively, was chasing people down the street, was approaching neighbours. He ran at police. One of the police officers then discharged their firearm.
The man who was killed is 41-year-old Steve Pampalian. He lived with his parents. Friends of the family arrived to be told the news. His cousin, who didn't want to be identified, described him as a kid, kind and soft-hearted. The Assistant Commissioner says she intends to view the officer's body cam video this evening.
It does sound like you're more satisfied that their action is appropriate rather than a taser being used.
With the information that is before me at this stage and noting the speed at which I understand the person approached police, yes, I am.
Mark Burrows, Nine News.
When she sang, she couldn't stand still. Tina Turner's high-powered voice only matched by the endless energy she generated on stage. If her death at the age of 83 has come as a sad surprise, it's because she seemed ageless. There was a great Australian connection with Tina, but first, her journey from hardship to stardom.
Quite simply, Tina Turner was the queen of rock and roll. The power behind our rugby league anthem. Who made every performance electric. A roaring voice, a well-known step, and that hair. Tina was behind so many classic hits. For decades, it was one after another. Not only idolised by the public, but her peers. Today's R&B queen, Beyoncé, paying tribute. You are the epitome of power and passion. Mick Jagger saying Tina was inspiring, warm, funny and generous. From Elton John, a total legend on record and on stage. She was untouchable. And from Tina's good friend Oprah, Tina lived out of the box and encouraged me and every woman to do the same. The Obamas saying Turner was a star whose light will never fade. And from President Joe Biden, a once-in-a-generation talent that changed American music forever. Tina Turner was born Anna Mae Bullock in 1939. She picked cotton as a young girl living in Tennessee. Her mother was a survivor of domestic violence. At 11, she was taken in by her grandmother in Nutbush, a rural community which she made famous in song. In 1957, Anna Mae met Ike Turner. Their partnership changed her life, finding success through the Ike and Tina Turner Review. They married and had children, but a dark fact was hidden from the public. Ike was an abuser.
It was just the sameness and the violence and you just get fed up and you say, life is not worth living if I'm going to stay in this situation.
After 16 years, she left him. The next chapter saw her head down under.
Do you mind doing that Nutbush City Limit?
I still have fun, actually, yeah. Especially here in Australia because the kids made a dance for it at the last trip and it's still going strong.
Soon, Tina found big screen stardom, filming Mad Max in Cooper Petey, Mel Gibson, her co-star.
Right or wrong, we had a deal.
Then she was beamed into homes, energising footy fans with this. Her Australian manager, Roger Davies, credited with her extraordinary comeback.
Roger's the brother I never had.
Today he said, I will miss her deeply. And for all of Tina's success, she never stopped searching for something.
You know, Oprah, what I think? I really needed love.
She found it with Erwin Bach, a German actor and music producer, who would give her his kidney when she became sick.
Is there anything you want now in life as you sit here, Tina Turner, that you don't have?
No, I have everything.
This was her final onstage performance in 2009. She bowed out with 12 Grammys, a Lifetime Achievement Award, record-breaking tours, and 180 million album sales. She stepped away from the spotlight battling cancer, seeking a quieter life with her husband in Switzerland. Her life story inspiring a musical, hitting the West End and Broadway.
I can never be as happy as I am now.
Here in Hollywood, outside Capitol Records, the label that helped reignite her career, a star and flowers, a chance for fans to mourn the loss but also remember the life and music of Tina Turner.
She's simply the best.
Last month, in one of her final interviews, a message on closure. Maybe that's the answer, to keep moving forward, to let go, and aim to fill your life with love. That is where I am now. And I am grateful. Hers is a voice that will endure long beyond her passing. In the United States, Jonathan Kersley, 9 News.
And in sport, we'll have a look at Tina Turner's extraordinary contribution to Australian Rugby League and speak to the stars who took part in that iconic campaign. Nine News can reveal tonight what police allege happened in the lead-up to 95-year-old Claire Nowland being tasered in her Cooma nursing home. The great-grandmother passed away not long after Senior Constable Christian White was charged, and we have now learned the officer plans to defend the case.
A day after Claire Nowland's death, new allegations about the moments before she was tasered. Nine News can reveal Senior Constable Christian White allegedly said bugger it as he deployed his taser. Police allege Mrs. Nowland was holding a steak knife when the officer said stop several times and drop it. She raised the knife to chest height in his colleague's direction. Senior Constable White asked her to stop before deploying the taser, saying bugger it.
He is very distressed. I don't think there's any dispute that on his way to this particular job that it was in his wildest dreams that the matter would unfold in the way that it may have.
The 33-year-old is charged with recklessly causing grievous bodily harm.
At this stage, I'd anticipate that he'd enter a plea of not guilty. All these matters will be reviewed when a brief of evidence is received.
Those charges could be upgraded to manslaughter, but investigators will have to wait on the result of an autopsy as they need to prove that the tasering caused the injuries that led to Mrs. Nowland's death. Today, news of the much-loved volunteer's death hit home.
A bit numb, I think. It's unfortunate that Cooma's been put on the map under unfortunate circumstances.
Well, I was just up at St Patrick's Church and noticed that the flag is at half-mast, which really says to all of us that even if you didn't know her, that she really was an important member of this community.
A mother to 8, grandmother to 24, and a great-grandmother to 31.
With Claire, the thing that struck me most was her love of the family. She's left a wonderful legacy. I think they'll all be inspired by the example of her life.
Emma Partridge, 9 News.
Mortgages, rent, grocery prices, and now your electricity bill is on the rise. From July 1, energy retailers will hike their rates, but the Albanese government says there are steps to help you save.
Tonight, these are the sounds of more dollars out your door, the cost of electricity set to rise.
At a time when Australian households are thinking, could it get any harder? It's going to get harder.
Standing offers in New South Wales and Queensland will rise from July 1. Household bills in New South Wales up on average over $480 for the year. Queensland prices expected to rise by $400. Small businesses will see jumps of at least 15%.
Of course, these are big increases, but also, as the regulator made clear herself this morning, without the intervention of the Albanese government, they would have been much bigger.
The Prime Minister explicitly and repeatedly promised that he would deliver cheaper electricity.
He voted against helping people. He voted against $3 billion in direct bill relief.
That power bill relief offered in the budget will likely cover those increases for the 5 million homes that qualify.
Why did the Prime Minister break his promise and lie to the Australian people?
We provided in the budget $1.6 billion for energy efficiency upgrades.
Those include induction cooktops, household batteries, electric hot water and insulation available to subsidised homes like Todd Smith's.
We noticed a significant reduction in our gas usage after we got insulated.
Energy providers are required to offer assistance to Australians who can't afford their bills. The government may have to offer a little more assistance in the future as well. Charles Croucher, Nine News.
A 64-year-old man has been charged over a spate of alleged sexual touching incidents in Sydney spanning two decades. He is accused of inappropriately touching four women, the first reported incident in 2002. He was arrested on Elizabeth Street at Liverpool this morning. A pitch invader has pleaded guilty to assaulting Dragons player Zach Lomax while causing a spectacle during the Anzac Day NRL match against the Roosters. 19-year-old Curtis Queeley has already been banned from New South Wales stadiums for 2 years. And next month, the Maroubra man will learn his punishment in court. Melissa Caddick's disappearance may forever remain a mystery. An inquest unable to determine how the fraudster died. There were chaotic scenes outside court today after husband Anthony Coletti was slammed by a coroner, his account riddled with inconsistencies, sparking suspicion he's hiding something.
Does Anthony Coletti know more than he's letting on?
Anthony, do you have anything to hide?
Married to the country's biggest con woman and now suspected of a cover-up, an accusation he is clearly not happy about.
He had some awareness of Ms. Caddick's movements, but he chose not to disclose it.
Melissa Caddick vanished the morning after ASIC raided her Dover Heights home in 2020.
The necklaces were 80 to 100.
The 49-year-old wasn't reported missing for 30 hours. Police initially suspicious of her husband.
Look, Anthony, I'll be honest with you. I'm a bit worried that you're not telling me the full story about what's going on.
This is the full story.
But the theories changed as a $20 million Ponzi scheme was unravelled. Was Caddick hiding, murdered, or did she take her own life? Then the conspiracy. The mother amputated her own limb after her shoe and foot washed up on the south coast. The inquest put an end to any speculation. The fraudster could still be living among us. It is possible Melissa Caddick jumped from the cliffs here at Dover Heights, but the coroner found there's not enough evidence to prove any scenario. What is clear is the mess that's been left behind. In Dover Heights, Tiffany Genders, Nine News.
A group of primary school students at Lidcombe have run for their lives, an elderly woman losing control of her car and hurtling through a sports carnival.
Huddled up for their team talk, Year 5 and 6 students from Lidcombe Primary School ready to take the field against Panania for an AFL Gala Day. 5 minutes into the second half, the game is interrupted. A sedan losing control on Woods Road at Birrong, crashing through a fence and driving straight through the middle of the match early yesterday.
I saw a whole cloud of smoke cross the thing and then noticed the car in the middle of the park.
and thought, oh, I hope they haven't hit the kids.
11-year-old Noah and his friends were on the field at the time. They can be seen running out of the way.
I saw the car, I heard it make like a sound, and then as soon as it hit the gate, I started like running for my life.
By some miracle, no one was hit. The driver, a 71-year-old woman, helped from the car. That's when teachers began calling parents.
They started the phone call with, Noah's okay, but there wasn't an accident at the AFL today.
Mum Mariana's nerves eased after this quick video message.
Tell your mum you're fine.
I'm fine.
Alhamdulillah.
It's believed this driver suffered a medical episode causing her to lose control of the car. She was taken to Auburn Hospital for checkups, but today is said to be doing fine. After the near miss, there was no way Noah could avoid a kiss and cuddle at school drop-off this morning.
Love you, Noah.
Love you too.
I'm very lucky.
In Birrong, James Wilson, Nine News.
Returning now to tonight's fire emergency, and more than 100 firefighters are still battling a blaze at Surry Hills in Sydney CBD. Let's go live to reporter Bianca Bowser, who's with Acting Commissioner Jeremy Futrell from Fire and Rescue New South Wales. Evening, Bianca.
Evening, Pete. The person we will speak to, as you said, is Acting Commissioner Jeremy Futrell. Jeremy, exactly what is the situation at the fire ground right now?
Yeah, so we have had a very intense and fast developing fire. Fortunately, our crews have been able to get on top of that and contain the fire. The fire now is still burning, but there's no further risk of it spreading to any other adjoining buildings. But unfortunately, there's been very substantial damage to the two buildings involved.
You've been a firefighter for 26 years. How do you describe this? How does it compare to what you've seen before?
Oh, look, certainly right up there. And I think the community got to see that, the ferocity of the fire in full force this afternoon, of how quickly it spread and the size that it got to as well, and the speed at which all that occurred. So very fast moving, very severe fire, had a lot of risk for the community and particularly those people in surrounding buildings. So it was a big, big effort for our firefighters to bring that into control.
Is it too early to say whether there'll be an arson investigation?
Oh, look, after every fire, and particularly a significant fire, we do a very thorough investigation on the cause of the fire. So that will just be part of our normal procedures. As part of that, we work closely with police forensics, and they'll work through the material they find there and make an assessment of whether there's anything else to be concerned about.
Thank you, Acting Commissioner. A very long night ahead for Acting Commissioner Jeremy Futrell and the team. Back to you, Pete.
OK, thanks so much, Bianca. Police have released dramatic body cam footage from the scene of a school shooting in Perth yesterday. A 15-year-old boy tonight remains in custody after allegedly firing three shots on his former campus.
Police facing something they could hardly expect to deal with in Australia.
There's a classroom at the end. They were all hiding in. It's all done. Yeah.
School bags litter the hallways. Students remain hiding under their desks. Outside, officers quickly arrest the 15-year-old former student and locate his car.
We have the vehicle with all firearms in the vehicle. One male in custody.
On the front seat of the boy's car, two rifles and a gun bag. Police also found three bullet casings, one on the floor mat of the car, and bullet holes in the school's demountable building. This school practices lockdown drills twice a year. Everyone acted immediately.
Turn the lights off. We were in cooking, so we had to turn all the stoves off and lock all the doors, move everything up against the door, like all that sort of stuff. So we knew we had to act quick.
WA Premier Mark McGowan visited today, praising staff and students for their bravery under extreme pressure.
Obviously, it was traumatic, and this is the sort of thing that you see on television in the United States. It's not the sort of thing you expect or should expect to see happen here in Australia.
With 360,000 firearms in Western Australia, the government will now reform gun laws. But in another troubling development, police are searching for a man who held up a gun store in Busselton, south of Perth, this morning. Armed with a pistol, he stole a rifle and ammunition before fleeing. Eddie Meyer, Nine News.
The US North Pacific territory of Guam has been thrashed by a powerful typhoon. Much of the island left without power and facing an enormous cleanup. Trees were knocked over, cars flipped by the wind. The weather system is expected to strengthen over the next 24 hours. King Charles and Queen Camilla have been serenaded by a school choir just outside Belfast on the royal couple's first visit to Northern Ireland since their coronation. They opened the newly completed coronation garden with its eye-catching spinning trees sitting in motorised pots. Dangerous and distracting vision has emerged of a man bus surfing through Sydney's inner southern suburbs. The video was captured along Gardiner's Road between Kingsford and Rosebery. Police are looking into the incident. One person is dead after a collision between a car and an ambulance near Narooma on the south coast this afternoon. The driver of the car died at the scene. The ambulance was carrying a child patient and mother. They have only minor injuries. One of two paramedics is in a serious condition. A scare for a couple at Balgala Heights this morning. Their go-get rental car exploding in flames just after 11 o'clock. They noticed smoke coming from the bonnet and pulled over on Beatrice Street before the car became engulfed in flames. The blaze so intense, parts of the rental melted onto the road. They make an unlikely pet and an even more unlikely theft. But that's exactly what happened to two rare pythons snatched from a pet store at Beaumont Hills. The reptiles need special care, staff tonight pleading for their safe return.
Browsing the reptile display at Kellyville Pet Store, three thieves on a cold-blooded mission. Two stand by as another in a hood breaks into a cage, pinching two albino pythons before tucking them into his pockets.
My stomach just dropped. Like, I knew straight away from, like, the scene that I knew what had happened.
The reptile robbers struck around midday yesterday while Will and other staff members were working close by. The stolen juvenile snakes, nicknamed Toasty and Marshmallow, which will eventually grow to up to 2.5 metres long, aren't venomous but valuable.
They were both around the $700 mark. They definitely still are, like, the more sought after out of, like, the carpet python people. Definitely would be in it for the money if they were breeding them.
Staff here were particularly concerned about the pythons' well-being as they require special care in the lead-up to winter and hibernation.
They're not given the proper heating and lighting, especially at this time. It can be, yeah, pretty detrimental to their health.
But this afternoon, a snake through. Police seizing the pythons from a St Clair home and returning them to the store. A 17-year-old boy now speaking with police.
Hopefully that snake fought pretty hard for him, you know, left with a few bites.
In Beaumont Hills, Elizabeth Bryan, Nine News.
All right, we have new developments at the Surry Hills fire where animals are being rescued from evacuated buildings nearby. Let's go straight to Nine. Sophie Upcroft. Soph, there are residents desperately waiting to be reunited with their pets.
That's right, there are, Pete, and emotions are really running high here around Surry Hills. I'm with Helen. Helen lives in the apartment building next door to where the fire has happened, that apartment building where we've seen the flames come very close to. Helen was at work this afternoon when she got the call from a neighbour to come and rescue her pets. Helen, how was that moment for you when they called you?
I feel like my hand shook in, and then, like, I feel like, oh my goodness, what happened with my cat? And then I very, very, very worried about him.
Yeah.
And then just, like, go here, and then, like, my manager get me go home early. That's why. And then, like, I go home and call the police.
Yeah. Yeah. And how many pets do you have in your home? It must have been so scary for you to be worried about them like that.
I have more than five.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then, like, I have more cat in my apartment already.
And this is Waffle and Moo Moo here. How are they doing?
So they're just, like, scared, and then, like, straight run away for the room.
Yeah, and how are you feeling tonight?
I feel very sad and very bad, and then I want to move apartment because I have 2 more weeks, and then I move, but, like, now get an accident like this, I don't want to stay here anymore, and then I will move to the other place very soon.
It's a huge relief to see them safe though.
Yeah.
Tonight there are hundreds more residents in apartment buildings around here who are going through exactly what Helen is going through tonight, so certainly still an emotional time here tonight, Pete.
Sophie, Helen, Waffle and Moo Moo, thank you. Those pot plants in your living room or the office might be better friends than you imagined. Research by Sydney's University of Technology, uncovering the way plants remove toxic petrol fumes from indoor air. A handy revelation for city dwellers, petrol fumes blamed for an increased risk of cancer and asthma. Swiss neuroscientists say they've made an astonishing breakthrough that has allowed a paralysed man to walk again. The team has used artificial intelligence to re-establish communication between the man's brain and his spinal cord.
Neuroscientists are describing the revolutionary technology as transforming thought into action, allowing 40-year-old Dutch man Hertjan Ozkam, who was paralysed in a cycling accident more than a decade ago, to walk again by simply thinking about it.
A few months ago, I was able to, for the first time after 10 years, to stand up and have a beer with my friends, so that was pretty cool.
Swiss researchers say they've created a wireless digital bridge repairing the broken connection between the brain and spinal cord by placing an electronic implant in the part of the brain responsible for controlling leg movements with a second implant over the spinal cord.
So when everything is installed, the patient has first to learn how to work with his brain signals, and we also have to learn how to correlate this brain signal to the spinal cord stimulation.
Hertjan is the first and only patient the so-called digital bridge has been tested on. The result?
The most surprising thing, I think, happened after 2 days. Within 5 to 10 minutes, I could control my hips.
The Dutch engineer is now able to stand, walk, even climb stairs. And scientists say some of the improvements have remained even after the technology was switched off. They hope it could one day be used to restore arm and hand functions as well. In London, Kariane Greenbank, Nine News.
It will be the biggest drone show in the Southern Hemisphere, and secret rehearsals for Written in the Stars, part of the Vivid Festival, have taken place at Eastern Creek ahead of the first show this Sunday.
This really has to be seen to be believed. 1,000 drones in a drone storm over Sydney. This will be more shows, more drones than people have ever seen before as part of Vivid.
Vivid kicks off tomorrow night. Crowds, of course, urged to catch public transport to the city.